Welcome to a live session of Ask an Imam. My name is Farhan Iqbal, and this is a live program where you can ask any questions about Islam, about Ahmadiyyat, about other world religions. This is the English Ask an Imam. As you are aware, we have some colleagues who have joined us who are now doing these programs in Urdu as well. One of my colleagues, Farhan Rabbani Sahib, he just did his program a few hours ago in the Urdu language. This program is being streamed live on multiple platforms. That includes Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. On any of these platforms, you can reach out to me. You can submit your questions. If you are on Twitter, you can use the main stream itself to submit a question. If you are on YouTube, you can use the live chat feature to submit your question. And if you are on Facebook, you can use the comment section to submit your questions. I already have a question from YouTube. I'll get to that in just a moment. Just wanted to mention at the very beginning that alislam.org is the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. You can see the website listed here on your screen as well, alislam.org. Now, on alislam.org, we have on the very first page, on the main page when you go there, we have a section that's called What's New. If you go to the What's New section, it tells you the things that have been added in recent days. So you can see just from 2 days ago, we have a couple of additions. One is an article on Islam and hygiene, the inextricable link between physical and spiritual purity that you can read on this page at your convenience, that talks about the various important aspects of physical hygiene that impact our spirituality as well. And the second edition on the same day, February 4th, is an audiobook. This is a book by Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him, the promised Messiah and Imam Mahdi alayhi salam. And it is available in audio format, read by Atif Rashid Sahib. A wonderful book if you want to learn more about the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. You can also find the complete, I clicked on the complete book and it actually starts playing. If you want to get the books itself, see the complete list of books, you can click on books on the top here. And it will take you to this page where the authors are listed, and you click on Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him, and all his books are listed on this page. Okay, so this is the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, www.alislam.org. This is an Ask an Imam where you can ask any questions about Islam, about Ahmadiyyat, about other world religions. I've received a question from YouTube. One person, I'm assuming this is a boy, who is asking me that how do you do tabligh or preaching to girls? When it comes to preaching, please always remember that if you are a male member of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, it is preferable that you preach to other males only. And if you come across a female who is interested in the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, in Islamic teachings, you can always direct them to the women's auxiliary of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community that is entitled Lajna Imaila. So you can always forward this information, the information about this person, to the members of the women's organization, women's auxiliary organization of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. You can also share this website with them, alislam.org, and whatever questions they have about Islam, about Ahmadiyyat. It's very easy to find answers to these questions on the website. There's a search bar that they can use to find answers to their questions. There is the books that are available, books of the Promised Messiah. Normally, someone who is new to Islam, we always suggest that they read the philosophy of the teachings of Islam as an introduction to the beliefs of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, and also an introduction to the promised Messiah, who is the founder of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. We also share some other books, depends on their interest. One common book is Revelation, Rationality, Knowledge and Truth, written by Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmed, Rahimahullah Ta'ala. Then we have books of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih the Fifth, our current Caliph, His Holiness Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmed, may Allah be his helper. He has some books, and depends on what kind of conversation is going on, and we send them those books that are related to that. Okay? Okay, another question from YouTube is that, what is the guidance for doing tabligh by using social media? There are some recent sessions with Huzur-e Anwar, may Allah be his helper, where this was discussed. And if you go to alislam.org, on the main page here, you on the right side, it says, This Week with Huzur. Okay, This Week with Huzur. In one recent video of This Week with Huzur, you have him discussing social media and tabligh on social media. And he has talked about it. I'm talking from my memory here. Actually, let's type it on before I answer your question. Let's type it and see if we can find some material on social media. There's obviously this book by Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmed, may Allah be his helper, on the topic of social media, which is a collection of some of his addresses on social media, and he has definitely talked about tabligh in that regard as well. There's a lot of tarbiyat aspect to it, there's a lot of moral upbringing aspect to it, but there's also tabligh aspect. Preaching has been discussed in this as well. So there's, you know, you can just use the term preach and search, and you will find some related quotations of the Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmed, may Allah be his helper, on this topic. There are some other resources here on tabligh that you can, you know, or benefits of social media. There you go. It's actually in the search results. This week was Huzur, 6th March 2020. And one of the questions that was asked is, how can we use social media for tabligh purposes? So you have this discussion in here. You can watch this video to get some understanding and some idea about this. But generally speaking, from what I recall, in the guidance of Huzur-e Anwar, may Allah be his helper, is to always be patient when we are doing tabligh on social media, because we are going to get messages that are meant to provoke anger. So always restraining ourselves, always being patient, always praying to Allah for help. And of course, keeping the dialogue positive and healthy, and more like a dialogue instead of a debate. So these are some of the points, but of course I cannot repeat them myself just based on memory. It's good that if you go actually to the source that I should just showed you and try to understand it from there. Okay. All right. One person has mentioned on YouTube that he is from the UK. And it is very late at night in the UK. Yes, I understand that. I am from Canada, so the time zone is very different. I have some colleagues in the United Kingdom and other parts of the world who are doing these programs. So if you are able to subscribe to this channel, you are writing to us from YouTube. Subscribe to the channel, hit the bell icon, so you are informed whenever there is a live session going on, and some of these sessions are being held at a time which is more suitable for you. I have this time slot, which is later in the evening, which obviously does not work well for you. So I hope you can benefit from those other programs. All these programs that we are doing are available for later viewing as well on YouTube. You can just watch any of the previous videos we have done as well, if you like. Okay. Another person has asked from YouTube is that why can't Ahmadis marry a Shia if the Shias agree not to curse the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, and could convert to Ahmadiyyat in the future? You know, when it comes to marriage, it's not a it's you have to understand that there are many factors that are involved. And you know, in this case also, there are some factors involved. If it's a boy who's getting married to a girl, there are some rules for that, and some observation is made. I mean, definitely this is not something that is ideal, because when people of different sects of Islam are marrying, it can cause difficulties in the marriage later on. So it's not an ideal situation. It is a situation where you can create certain difficulties. And I have firsthand experience seeing some families struggle because of belonging to different sects within Islam. But if it's something that they really, really want, then there are some rules to follow, and some factors come into play, and it can be processed through the system of the Jamaat. And with we have our Caliph, His Holiness Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad, may Allah be his helper. Permission can be sought from him. So something can be done, but it depends on the situation. It's not a blanket answer that I can give you for all that can apply to all situations. It depends on the situation. It depends on the circumstances in which that is going on. Okay. Another person has asked, what my question is about dua. How long does a dua take to happen? I believe you're trying to ask that how long does it take for a dua to be accepted? You know, it is totally up to Allah. There are some occasions where it is the morning and we ask and pray to Allah for something, and by evening we have it. There are some occasions where we ask Allah for something and within a few hours we get exactly what we desired. And there are other occasions where the decree of Allah is such that what we are asking can take years. And there are reasons for that. And it depends on the circumstances. It depends on what we are exactly asking. And definitely in some circumstances it can take long. Why does that happen? The answer to that question is that Allah, in His infinite wisdom, requires it to happen that way. Because there are some things that we might think, I want it tomorrow, but it might not be good for us tomorrow. We might be asking Allah for something in the immediate future, but it might be something that, if granted to us in the immediate future, would become harmful for us. We don't know. You know, the whole idea behind dua is to ask Allah, who is the knower of the unseen, to grant us something out of His knowledge of the unseen, things that we do not know, things that we are not aware of, things that are beyond our ability to understand. So we ask Allah to grant us from that knowledge of the unseen, make it happen for us, make it easy for us. And in some cases, Allah knows that if something is granted to us right away, is going to be harmful and not beneficial at all for us. In some other cases, it is different. Okay. So that's the one perspective on this. If you are looking for a slightly more detailed answer, there is something I had a chance to submit to Al-Islam some time ago, and it's a question. My prayers are not being answered. If you type that on alislam.org, you come across this section, my prayers are not being answered. What do I do? And there is some discussion here. And just like I said, even the Quran, you know, we have this verse of the Holy Quran. Allah says, "Auzu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, wa asa an takrahu shay'an wa huwa khairul lakum." that there are times when we dislike something, but it is actually good for us. وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ. And there are times when we think that something is good and likable, but in fact, it is bad for us. So Allah knows. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ. Allah knows what is good. وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And you do not know. So we are not the ones who have that knowledge of the unseen. Okay? All right. I have several other questions here. One person has said that non-Ahmadi channels are challenging Ahmadis to come and do live discussion. Why Jamaat does not accept these challenges? You know, because a lot of times on social media, and we were talking about social media a little earlier as well, is that when you go into these kinds of discussions, they actually are not discussions. They are meant to, do kinds of debates and put the other person down. So that's why we don't like to create a situation where the other person is just taking the opportunity to make some comments that are inappropriate about the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, or someone else, just to get likes on their video or just to get their popularity going, right? Even myself, a couple of years ago, I had an opportunity to have a discussion with a Christian. And we were very clear in the beginning that there should be no insults launched at Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we have to have a cordial kind of a discussion, and I at my end will also not say anything that would be disrespectful or insulting. We can have an academic discussion that why someone does not believe Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be a true prophet, but nothing that would be inappropriate, right? And the other person was asking for a live discussion, but I didn't go for that. And it was it happened exactly according to my fears, that just by about an hour into the discussion, when the other person just felt like that this is not going so well, they made some personal attacks on Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So on a live discussion, these kinds of things can happen, and sometimes they have a very a purpose of just to get some likes on social media, because whenever we say something controversial on social media, it tends to get that popularity. So that's one of the reasons why we don't want to go into every kind of discussion of this nature, that we just rush into these kinds of discussions where there are no rules, there are no boundaries, everything goes. So that kind of discussion we don't. But at the same time, there are discussions where we have had a very healthy dialogues, and there are some debates even that are available on YouTube with very senior scholars of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, and we have done those. And you know, that's one of the reasons why we have programs like this as well. In our Jamaat, we have on MTA, for instance, we have lots of programs that have open question and answer. And we have this program as well, where, you know, and not just myself, but there are many of my colleagues who are doing these programs. The idea is that we keep it cordial, we keep it healthy, we keep it proper, and we're not doing anything which is, we're not, you know, getting into that kind of debate mode. We are more into discussion. We are more into healthy dialogue instead of, things that are just, there is no control over. Okay? So these are some of the reasons why this is done. A question that I missed earlier is from Facebook. It's related to jurisprudence, that what if someone has a sickness and after urinating they are not clean all the time, and there is some kind of condition that is causing that, because as we just talked about in the beginning, We have, you know, physical cleanliness is very much intricately linked to spiritual cleanliness. So what is going on there? In those cases, there is an exception, right? Because a person who has an illness and it is causing that that they are not able to maintain their cleanliness all the time, that is okay. They can take whatever due precautions that are available to them, keep themselves as clean as possible, and before every namaz, they just do wuzu and they can offer the namaz. They don't have to, you know, be too worried about it because it's a part of their illness. They can wear certain kinds of clothes that can help keep themselves as clean and hygienic as possible. But those are exceptions to the rule, right? There are, you know, in some instances, it's not possible to keep that level of cleanliness. So we can, Islam is a religion of ease. It's not meant to create difficulties for us. And so it's okay. They can offer, they can do wuzu and do their ablution and offer the prayer. Okay. Another person has asked a question that is not related to this, to my usual topics, but he's asking, how do you write Arabic online? Online, there are some keyboards, there are some websites. If you just Google search this, just type Arabic or something into Google, and it will take you to certain websites that allow you to see the keyboard, and you can click on the different letters to type in Arabic if you like. Okay, what is Islam's perspective on interstellar space travel? Do we humans need to become a multi-planetary civilization? Are there any prophecies in regard to this? There is that prophecy. I believe that you must have heard of that prophecy that I've mentioned numerous times in my live streams. It is about meeting extraterrestrial life. It is, if you want to read on more on that, it is available on alislam.org. Just type in extraterrestrial life on alislam.org and you will come across the prophecy of human beings eventually coming into some kind of contact where Allah says, وَهُوَ عَلَىٰ جَمْعِهِمْ إِذَا يَشَاءُ قَدِيرٌ, and He has the power to gather them together when He will so please. So Allah has this, there is this prophecy about some kind of bringing together of alien life form and human life form. But the Quran hasn't told us about the further details about interstellar space travel itself. That has not been mentioned directly. But if people have to be brought together, you know, jam'ihim is the word that has been used in the reference from the Quran, that would mean that there is some kind of travel involved as well, right? Because as we do know that there is, you know, the planets and the stars are light years, many, many light years away from one another. So there will have to be some kind of travel. And interestingly enough, if you are talking about this travel between planets, one theory is that because the human lifespan is so short, it would not be possible for one human to cover this time in one lifespan. So one idea is that there is some kind of hibernation that is involved, that a person sleeps for 100 years and then gets to the other planet or star or wherever. And this hibernation is also something that is mentioned in the Holy Quran. So there is actually a prophet of Allah who is mentioned to have slept for 100 years. Now, of course, there is a metaphorical aspect to this. And let me see if I can search for that verse of the Holy Quran. I don't recall it from memory, the reference. But definitely the word 100 years or so has been used in that verse. Okay, there you go. It's chapter 2, verse 260, where Allah says, or like him who passed down by a time which had fallen down upon its roofs and exclaimed, when will Allah restore it to life after its destruction? Then Allah caused him to die for 100 years, right? It says, فَأَمَاتَهُ اللَّهُ مِئَةَ عَامٍ ثُمَّ بَعَثَهُ قَالَ كَمْ لَبِثْتَ. So it goes on. I mean, I'm not going to read through the entire verse, but it talks about this, and the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, has actually referred in the commentary of this verse, and I won't hunt for that commentary at this point, but because it will take a little bit too long. But, you know, it's an interesting idea about, you know, sleeping for 100 years and being raised, you know, and coming back to life, sort of, because the word amata is used for sleep as well, because, you know, when we go to bed at night, the prayer that we offer as Muslims uses the word amutu, right, which is referring actually to sleep. It is not, you know, so it's something that the Quran is hinting as a possibility, right? Allah knows best when human beings would be able to understand these possibilities, but this is hinted in the Quran. And if you link it with the other verse about meeting extraterrestrial life, we are actually talking about space travel for sure. Okay. One other thing that I would like to mention before I move on to the next question, and I have a few questions already, that when it comes to space travel, do keep in mind that in the future, Allah may reveal something about this, because the Quran's meanings can keep on, we can keep on exploring the Quran even in the future. So in the future, Allah may reveal something to one of the Khulafa, and that would open up certain meanings of the Quran related to this subject. As Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad Rahimahullah Ta'ala has beautifully explained the idea of extraterrestrial life mentioned in the Quran, so maybe in the future, even more meanings would be driven out of this, and we would have even more of an understanding of this. Okay? All right. How many Ahmadis are there in the world? 200 million or 20 million? So the exact number is impossible to know, because not in every part of the world we don't have a very intricate system of you know, lists of Ahmadis, and we don't have that kind of those kinds of numbers, but we are for sure spread in almost all of the countries of the world. So 212 or 214 countries of the world, the seed of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community has been planted there, right? And there are easily, and this is a rough estimate, there are easily 50 to 60 countries of the world where we have annual conventions as well. So we normally say that our number is in the tens of millions, because the exact number is not known to us precisely. So, you know, we have these numbers. There is a number that we have of, for instance, people who participate in Tehreek-e-Jadeed or Waqf-e-Jadeed that is officially announced every year, which is a form of, you know, financial sacrifice, one of the areas in which we offer financial sacrifices. So that number can easily go to 2 million, right? Or close to 2 million rather. So we have that kind of number, but the actual number of all the Ahmadis across the world, you know, that's a larger number that we do not have a precise estimate of. So, you know, when we say that there are 150 or 160 or 170 million Ahmadis in the world, that also includes a lot of people who are highly impressed by the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat, but are not able to enter the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat because of a whole varied number of reasons, right? Places where there's a lot of persecution, for instance. A lot of people would be hesitant to join a community, you know, while agreeing with their doctrines and belief system, but they would be hesitant to formally enter. In fact, from one of these countries in the Middle East, I came across one person just a few years ago who said, I cannot sign these papers to formally announce my entry into the community because I'm connected to some ministers in my home country. I don't want there to be some kind of problem that is created because of my conversion. But I agree with what you are saying. So there are lots of people who are like that, who are not able to formally enter the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. But if you're asking me for an exact number, I do not have the exact number. Okay. Another question is that if we offer witr prayers after Isha prayer at night, can we still offer it after the Hajjat prayer, as is the Sunnah? So this is a question I remember we used to discuss it in the days when I was a student in the Ahmadiyya Institute of Islamic Studies, Jamia Ahmadiyya. And, you know, some of the scholars were of the opinion that once you have already offered witr prayer at night, you should not offer it in the morning. And for most of the scholars, senior scholars that I have spoken to, they are of the opinion that once you have offered witr prayer at night, you cannot get up in the morning and offer witr again. Okay, this question is probably also something that must have been addressed in one of the Fiqhi Masail program on alislam.org. You can search for an answer, especially if you know how to write Urdu. So you can search especially or understand Urdu. You can definitely try a search on Al-Islam and see if you can find an answer, find the answer given in the Fiqhi Masail program. But it's something that, because it is, offered at night already, there's no need. Tahajjud is a time for nafil prayer. So if you're offering nafil prayer at tahajjud, it's good, okay? And it's not that witr prayers have to be offered again, okay? Another question is, did Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him, forbid debates? He did not forbid debates. There was a point in his life where he said that he is not going to get into those kinds of debates anymore. But it wasn't like something that has been totally forbidden, because there have been debates in the history of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. The ones that I know of, for instance, I've read this debate, the Cairo debate, which was a debate with one of our scholars, with a Christian scholar. So definitely those kinds of debates have taken place. Even recently, one of my colleagues, Ayaz Khan Sahib, had a debate with an atheist at a university a few years ago. So there definitely have been some debates in the history of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. So they are not forbidden. It's just that we prefer to have dialogue. We prefer to have, for instance, we have hundreds, thousands of interfaith events where we invite the other scholar to present his case for the truthfulness of his religion, and we present our case for the truthfulness of our religion. So those kinds of discussions and interfaith dialogue is more fruitful because it is not hostile and it is not meant to put the other person down or insult them. All right, another question. There's a lot of discussion on the internet about gender recognition. And of course, the far right are pro-twin gender, which is male and female. However, I have seen some arguments. So the Quran has talked about the two genders, male and female. So that's definitely very clear in the Quran. Where the men and the women are distinctly mentioned. There is nowadays talk of more of a gender fluidity, but so far I have not come across, I have not investigated myself too much into those writings of what their perspective is on this. But there have been counter arguments as well. People have responded to that as well, and they have talked about it. But at this point, this is a topic that I have not delved too much into. There are definitely people who are born in such a way that they cannot be identified directly as male or female, And there are people who are born that way, that is for sure. But that doesn't mean that we should lose the distinction between the male and female gender itself. Okay? Another person has asked that in the hereafter, are we able to meet our beloved ones? Yes, we are able to meet our beloved family in the hereafter. Okay? Another question has asked is how many Ahmadis? Okay, this question has been asked. I've answered that. Another question that has been asked by Basharat Ahmad Raza Sahib is that which, when we say that a witness of two women is equal to one, that of men, thus giving sort of an inferior cognitive ability to women as seen from some hadith. Please elaborate. So the issue of women, the two witnesses of the testimony of women being unequal to the testimony of men is actually a misconception about Islam. This is not how it is. Some time ago, I had an opportunity to write an article on this, about the testimony of women. I'm trying to, that's the title. Two female witnesses for one male witness, ? And I talk about this issue at length here. There's a small note that Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad Rahimahullah Ta'ala has given on this subject, and I've quoted it here in his book, from his book, Islam's Response to Contemporary Issues. And the link is available, page number is there if you want to read that portion as well. So I go into a detailed study of this, and the idea, first of all, is that when it comes to witnesses, the Quran is actually, when you look at the verse itself, the Quran is referring to the situation where the situation of business transaction. So this kind of testimony is required in a business transaction. It is not a general statement for all kinds of testimonies. Because if it was for all kinds of testimonies, then religious testimony, which is even more important, which is way more important than business transactions and worldly testimony. So in business, in religious testimony, we would always ask for two women. But one of the most common narrators of ahadith is Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha. And it has never been the case that when it comes to Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha, we are asking for another woman to testify that what she said is true. There are some things that she has narrated about the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from their private life where it was impossible for another person to be present. And she has narrated those things, and they are widely accepted in the Islamic world, and everyone accepts it. No one says that there should be a second witness. Okay, so that itself is a proof of the fact that whenever women have to testify, it doesn't mean that their testimony is 50%, while the man's testimony, a single testimony, is 100%. That's not the case. Even in the case of business transactions, there is one which is the prime witness and the other is a secondary or assistant witness, which is meant of more for convenience as opposed to anything else. So these are some points to consider that, and if you want to get a more detailed assessment of this, the article is there for you to study. Another question asked from YouTube is that Hazur has answered this question that if you do good deeds, and if your beloved ones do good deeds, then you will be able to meet each other in the hereafter. Yes, this is a response to someone who asked this question earlier. Okay, yes, Jazakallah for that. And always, if you have, you know, the link to the session where Hazur said this, it's always good to always share that here, so that it's part of the record. Those who are on YouTube, they can always check it from the live chat and click on it. Is there a video of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, talking in his lecture? There is no video of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, that I am aware of. There is no video. There are some very old videos of Qadian and Rabwa, but there is no video of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. There's no video of Hazrat Hakim Maulvi Nuruddin Sahib radiallahu anhu either. There was a recording done from our historical accounts. We do know there was a recording of the voices of Hazrat Hakim Maulvi Nuruddin Sahib, the first caliph of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, radiallahu anhu, may Allah be pleased with him. There was a recording that was done of him for sure that we know from our history. But that recording, as far as we know now, it has been lost to history. But you never know. Sometimes things just become available. And if Allah wishes, maybe it becomes available to us and we are able to retrieve it. Okay, but there are audio lectures of Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmad radiallahu anhu, may Allah be pleased with him, that are available on the other hand. One person has asked that, and has mentioned that the video technology did not exist at that time. I think phonograms, phonograms were available at that time. And the recording of Hazrat Hakim Maulvi Nuruddin Sahib radiallahu anhu was done on the phonogram. And that apparently, so far as I know, has been lost to history. Another person has asked from Facebook that there is an online Quran Academy. Could you please give us a link? You can send me a separate email for this. This is mostly intended for the Ahmadiyya Muslim community members. I don't know whether they are taking students from outside the community as well. I don't know the details of what the admission to that is. So send me a separate message. I will inshallah find the link. Right now, I don't know the link. I will find out the link and I will share it with you. Okay. Another question asked for by Zishan from YouTube is there anything in the Quran or Hadith or on aliens or extraterrestrial life? I already talked about this earlier in this program. At the time when you asked this question, I had answered it. Another question is about Ahmadis. Okay, I've answered this. Okay, some discussion here. Okay, some comments here. For some reason, I'm seeing repeated comments, so it's taking me longer to go sift through them. I am coming to near the end of this stream. Okay. Is there anything in the Quran? Okay, that question has also been answered. Yes, Zishan, I did talk about kind of a travel where you hibernate, and I mentioned a verse of the Holy Quran as well. Time travel itself, generally speaking, I am not aware if the Quran hints at it anywhere. But the verse that I did point out is saying something about that as well. So that's worth studying and learning about. Last question that I'm going to take for today is that, can you do nafal when combining Zuhr and Asr prayers? Yes, you can if you do it before. So before the start of Zuhr and Asr prayers, offer some nafal and then Zuhr and Asr prayers. So if you do it that way, then definitely you can offer some nafal prayers. All right, that's all the time I had. I have answered all the questions that were asked of me today. I really appreciate all of you who joined this program. Please do remember me and the alislam.org team in your prayers. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.